Okay, if I could ask members leaving the chamber and members of the public leaving the public gallery to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible as we move on to the next item of business, which is a members' business debate on motion 13270 in the name of Mark Ruskell on permanently ending peak rail fares on ScotRail. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I invite Mark Ruskell to open the debate around 7 minutes, please, Mr. Ruskell.
Yeah, thanks very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank members for signing the motion and those who've stayed behind to discuss and debate this afternoon. Now, last Wednesday...
Mr. Ruskell, could I ask you to resume your seat?
Yeah, sure.
Please, can I ask those in the public gallery... if they are leaving, to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible. Mr. Ruskell, if you could resume.
They may be running for their trains, you never know. Now, last Wednesday, I was delighted to join passengers on the first train to Leven and Cameron Bridge since 1969. I know the Transport Cabinet Secretary was there with me as well. And it was a wonderful moment, especially to join the tenacious campaigners from the Levenmouth Rail campaign. And it's quite clear that these new rail stations will change lives. Rail services are permanent and deliver far-reaching economic benefits, and by investing in rail we can connect communities and offer a fixed, greener, cheaper transport option for as many people as possible. And as a Green MSP, I've always been a strong advocate for investment in rail, from new rail stations to decarbonisations to reform in fare structures and pricing. I've repeatedly called for nationalisation of ScotRail and Caledonian Sleeper, and as a Green group we secured significant funding for rail as part of the Bute House Agreement, as the Cabinet Secretary knows. Fundamentally, I think we all agree that radically improving public transport is good for people, it's good for the economy, and it's good for the planet. Now, back in 2021, I met with the four rail unions outside the Parliament for the launch of A Vision for Scotland's Railways, and there is much in that report which we agreed on, and the removal of peak time fares on ScotRail was one of those ideas. So we've been proud to fight for and win the removal of peak time fares from ScotRail services for a trial six-month period that started in October 2023. And alongside the four rail unions and tens of thousands of passengers who felt the benefit of this transformative policy, we're now calling on the Scottish Government to make this change permanent. But why do simpler, cheaper rail fares matter? Transport is responsible for about a third of our greenhouse gas emissions in Scotland, and road transport alone makes up for about three quarters of these emissions, with a significant proportion of that coming from passenger car use. Scottish Government says it's still on track to achieve net zero by 2045, and it also has an important target of reducing car kilometres by 20% by 2030. So significant transformative investment in public transport, including rail, is essential if we have any hope of encouraging people out of polluting private cars and reducing Scotland's carbon emissions.
Would the member give way?
Certainly.
John Mason.
The member talks about investment. I just wonder if he knows, or if anybody knows, what the cost of the off-peak rail fares is or is likely to be, because that will be a factor on whether it could continue.
Mark Ruskell.
Well, the member makes a good point, and I think there was an allocation within this year's budget. But, of course, this is a changing picture, and it does depend on how many people actually get back onto the railways, if we can see that modal shift. But we know that that modal shift takes time, and I think this is an important point here in this debate, because this is about changing habits that have formed over a lifetime, and a lifetime in which governments of all shades have prioritised investment in roads and cars over public transport. Radical interventions in public transport fares clearly make a difference. Nearly three quarters of a million young people in Scotland now have access to free bus travel, and more than 137 million journeys have been made in just over 2 years. And of course, the National Entitlement Card for Bus goes further by also offering young people 50% off train fares. So we're already creating a generation whose first choice is public transport. And there are already, I think, some green shoots of progress emerging from the interim evaluation of the off-peak all-day pilot that was published earlier this week. Although the picture is yet to fully emerge, the data shows us that 53% of new rail passengers in the pilot period had previously chosen to travel by car. It also shows us that a third of existing rail users made at least one additional rail journey, which they would have ordinarily made by another travel mode, with two-thirds of those journeys normally by car. But if we want to see that long-term modal shift, we need to give people the security of knowing that peak time rail fares are gone for good. Only then can commuters start to plan their work and travel options around fixed rail services that are cost competitive with running a private car. Now, modal shift is an important objective for off-peak all-day pilot, but it's not the only reason securing cheaper and simpler fares matter. Budgets are still tight for many people across Scotland. And while inflation may have levelled out, the cost of living crisis has a long tail, with prices remaining high in many sectors. And I would hope that John Mason would acknowledge that point, that this has been important in terms of driving modal shift, but it's also been important as a cost of living measure. High rail fares, particularly at peak time, coupled with a complicated pricing structure, threatens to make rail an unattractive option in the future. And we can't stand still here. Rail must continue to grow its passenger demographic, not shrink it. So for those who commute to work at peak times, the cost pressure is even more stark. So let's outline this clearly. Before the pilot, someone travelling at peak times between Edinburgh and Glasgow was paying £28.90. Someone travelling between Glasgow and Stirling was paying £16.10. With the removal of peak time fares, those prices have been slashed by half in the case of Edinburgh to Glasgow. Cheaper rail fares will make train travel more attractive to both commuters and leisure travellers. And again, there are early indications in the pilot evaluation that this is having an effect. 78% of new rail passengers during the pilot, so they chose to get the train because of the pilot. Put simply, they got on board ScotRail because the tickets were cheaper. That simple. Now, it cannot be right for it to be cheaper, easier and simpler to choose private cars over public transport. Reforming antiquated and unfair structures like peak time fares is an important part of the picture. But we also need to think bigger. Creating incentives to reduce fares are just one side of that price equation. We cannot secure sustainable funding for transformative green transport solutions through driving up rail passenger numbers alone. We need to be brave and bold, and measures like congestion charging and workplace parking levies in the cities are needed to get a better balance between private car usage and public transport. We know the Scottish Government has done initial work on demand management. I look forward to seeing the final 20% plan. But we also need councils with strong leadership who can stand with the Scottish Government and drive through measures that will transform our cities for good. We also desperately need to see progress on integrated ticketing, something this Government has often promised but not yet delivered. It should go a huge way to improving passenger experience and delivering more affordable fare packages. So, Presiding Officer, in conclusion, with ScotRail now in public ownership, this really is our chance to deliver on a people's vision for ScotRail, one which makes rail affordable and accessible to as many people as possible, one which encourages folks to get out of cars and onto our incredible rail services. And getting rid of peak time fares is a very important step on that journey. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Roskell. We now move to the open debate. I call first Emma Harper, to be followed by Graeme Simpson. Around 4 minutes, Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate, and I congratulate Mark Roskell on securing it, and I will keep my contribution brief. The peak rail fare price removal has undoubtedly benefited people in many parts of Scotland, enabling people to travel by train more affordably. This has also had benefits in terms of emissions reductions and action against climate change. The removal of peak rail fares has also built on the SNP Government's commitment to making public transport more accessible and reliable, and encourage people to switch away from cars to cleaner, greener public transport. From expanding free bus travel to under 22-year-olds to putting money straight back into people's pockets with reduced rail fares, the SNP is helping people where it matters. Every pound saved can help mitigate the impact of the Tory-inflicted cost-of-living crisis. Presiding Officer, while the off-peak rail fare is welcome, it does not, however, benefit many of my constituents across South Scotland. For example, at present, there are no ScotRail services from Lockerbie to either Glasgow or Edinburgh. The West Coast mainline route is serviced by TransPennine Express and, on occasion, Avanti. Indeed, there are no rail services from Stranraer to Ayr at all at the moment, and there is a replacement bus service which takes substantially more time to get to Ayr than the rail service did. The reason for the no rail service hasn't been working for the last 8 months is because of the derelict Ayr Station Hotel. But this is not the responsibility of the Scottish Government, it's the responsibility of South Ayrshire Council. But it is another example of how my constituents from Stranraer, Wigginshire and East Ayrshire are not benefiting from the removal of the peak rail fares offer, which has been introduced by the Scottish Government. One other example of how South Scotland is disadvantaged is from the peak rail fare cut is at the recent Scottish Government £20 million investment in Reston Railway Station, which I visited just last week. It is an amazing, welcome, fantastic, accessible asset for people living in Reston and the surrounding areas of the Scottish borders. But there's no ScotRail services on the line. The station is serviced by TransPennine, Avanti, LNER and Lumo. And none of the operators offer non-peak rail fares at any time of day, meaning people across the south are indeed missing out. The one part of Dumfries and Galloway which does see the benefit is the Gretna to Glasgow line. But there are many constituents who choose not to use this service because it is much quicker to take the TransPennine Express from Lockerbie to Edinburgh, which takes 58 minutes, as opposed to the 2 hours it takes from Dumfries to Glasgow. I have lobbied successive transport ministers for improvements to the line in terms of reducing journey times and electrification. And the Strategic Transport Projects Review No. 2, the SDPR2, made recommendations for the line to be improved, and I've written to the Cabinet Secretary to request an update on intended timescales. Presiding Officer, in closing, I do welcome the extension of the peak rail fare cut. However, I would ask the Cabinet Secretary to consider the issues I've raised regarding how many communities across South Scotland may not benefit from this excellent pilot scheme. So I would ask the Cabinet Secretary whether she could explore whether transport officials, whether ScotRail could look to enter reciprocal and commercial agreements with other operators. This would mean that constituents on the Scottish stations which do not have ScotRail services could also benefit from non-peak fares at all times during the pilot scheme period. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Harper. I now call Graeme Simpson to be followed by Alec Rowley. Around 4 minutes, Mr Simpson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I congratulate Mark Ruskell on securing this debate? I was very happy to sign his motion because I agree with every word of it. I think the removal of peak fares on our trains has been a positive thing. I would like it to be permanent because my view has been for a long, long time that we need a simple fare structure. We need lower fares. And by having a simple fare structure, I really do mean what we currently have on our trains. I think it was off-putting to have a structure where people paid different prices at different times of the day. So what we have now, irrespective of the interim evaluation, which I think gave a mixed picture, I think we do it because it's the right thing to do. There would, of course, be a danger if we reverted to the previous system, is that it could actually discourage people from using the train. So that would be a negative thing. John Mason asked earlier, I see he's not in the chamber at the moment, but he asked for cost. There is a cost contained in the interim evaluation of £40 million. I think we need to see that as an investment rather than a burden on the public purse. I think getting fares lower is an investment. Now, Mark Ruskell covered quite a lot of ground. He mentioned smart ticketing or integrated ticketing. That's something I would like to see. I have a real frustration that the board that has been set up by the Scottish Government to look at this has been given 3 years to produce recommendations. I think we need to move a lot quicker than that. And the technology is being used elsewhere in the world, elsewhere in Europe. We could move quicker on this. And I've spoken to the Cabinet Secretary about this. I think 3 years is far too long. We need to get on with it. And it's all about making public transport, not just trains, but buses as well, easier to use. We have the announcement by the Cabinet Secretary of a pilot flat fare system. I'd like that to be announced very quickly. I think we need... I accept we're in an election period, but I think she needs to decide where that is going to be. That could be transformative. I've called for a fare cap, a £2 fare cap across Scotland. She's going for a slightly different system, but it amounts to the same thing. It's putting a limit on what bus travel should cost, and that is the way we need to go. Mark Ruskell also mentioned the government's ambition to cut car miles by 20%, but we've yet to see a plan for that. So I'd urge the Cabinet Secretary to get on with that as well. We need to know what the government thinks should be done to get people... Yes, I see Mr Ruskell wants to make an intervention, and I'm happy to take it.
Mark Ruskell.
Yeah, thanks very much to Graeme Simpson for taking the intervention. I mean, I'm enjoying hearing his acceptance, his enthusiasm for green policies, but I'm just interested in what his views are on demand management, because, you know, we can keep offering the kind of carrots of reduced fares and flat fares and free travel, but it does have to come to a point where we rebalance the cost of private car usage with public transport. Would he support demand management, for example, in the City of Edinburgh, if the council and local taxpayers wished to introduce it, that could lead to a transformative investment in public transport in this city, as it could in many other cities, while at the same time rebalancing that cost, which as he knows, is vastly skewed towards private car usage and away from public transport at the moment?
Graeme Simpson, if you could begin winding up, please.
Well, I'll just close by answering the point. My view is I'm more of a carrots than sticks man, and I think the kind of proposal that Mark Ruskell has come up with there would be hugely controversial, and that's possibly why the Cabinet Secretary has not said what she plans to do. But she does need to set out, and she does need to have discussions, probably across this Parliament, maybe in advance of announcing those things, because this is not easy, I accept that. But once again, I'll just congratulate Mark Ruskell for securing the debate and getting the chance to air a number of issues. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Alec Rowley to be followed by Ross Greer, around 4 minutes. Mr Rowley.
Presiding Officer, I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak in this debate today and to Mark Ruskell for bringing forward this motion. As an MSP and Scottish Labour's transport spokesperson, I have been consistent in my support for scrapping of the peak rail fares. I welcome the bold steps taken by the Scottish Government and continue to support the work they are doing on this, while also calling for the changes to be made permanent. And I am very pleased to see the mention of the rail unions in Mark Ruskell's motion today. The rail unions have often been overlooked when the discussions of this scheme take place. So it is important to remember that it was the rail unions who first proposed and campaigned for this ambitious action, and their members' efforts on delivering the staffing required that have made it such a success. As such, I would like to take the opportunity to pay tribute to all those in the trades union movement that have made the case for the policy change on behalf of the people of Scotland. Because the rail unions understand, as I do, that peak fares are only a tax on workers who are doing exactly what their government is asking them to do by leaving the car at home and travelling in a more sustainable way. And as we know, rail fares have increased at a far greater rate than the cost to travel by car. So is it any wonder that we are still struggling to get people to make the jump from car to public transport, particularly as people across the country are still struggling under a cost of living crisis? So I really do welcome the work that the government has done on peak fares. This is an example of policy that makes rail more affordable and accessible, which is why we must make this change permanent without delay.
Mark Ruskell.
Can I thank Alec Rowley for giving way, and in particular for his mention of the unions? I met with the four unions again on Monday this week, and what they told me is that from the perspective of workers, this scheme has been really successful because it simplifies the sale of tickets. It becomes very easy for workers selling tickets on our railways to explain the fact that there's a single fare throughout the entire day. They no longer have to have those difficult conversations about why a rail fare suddenly jumped up by 50%. So I think it's been great feedback that we've had from our incredible workers on the rail unions, railways as well.
Alec Rowley, I can give you the time back.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And as well as speaking to obviously rail unions, when you speak to rail workers when you're using the trains and when you speak to passengers in particular, this is a positive and welcome policy. This is an example of policy that makes rail more affordable and accessible, which is why we must make this change permanent without delay. As someone who firmly believes we must inspire a greater modal shift in transport, I have to say, Presiding Officer, I often despair at the punitive approach that is taken to transport policy. Rather than making public transport more attractive, I fear we often focus too much on making driving more unattractive, often without ensuring that the appropriate alternatives are in place. And when we talk about workplace parking levies, proposed road charging proposals to reduce road budgets even further, despite the worst road conditions in living memory, I believe we are taking the wrong approach. Because I do believe if people across the country had the option of a public transport system that was affordable, available and accessible, we would not need to figure out new ways to charge people for driving, because the desire to do so would simply not be there. It is why I have raised the need to ensure bus services remain affordable to those who do not benefit from the concessionary schemes, which I do, of course, support, and why I believe local authorities must be provided with the resources to explore local solutions to operating bus services in their areas. And it is why I'm supporting bringing a permanent end to rail fares. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rowley. And I call Ross Greer to be followed by Richard Leonard, around 4 minutes. Mr. Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like colleagues to thank Mark Ruskell for giving us the opportunity to debate this policy today. I'm really proud that the Scottish Greens were able to secure the funding and deliver on the removal of peak rail fares, a policy long advocated by rail unions and climate campaigners across Scotland and across the UK. It's the perfect example of a policy that acts in the interest of people and planet. Because as others have said, workers don't have a choice over when they commute. Students don't have a choice over when their lectures or tutorials are. Those attending medical appointments don't have that flexibility. ASLEF were absolutely right to call this, to call peak rail fares a de facto tax on workers. And I know that rail travel does skew towards those on higher incomes compared to bus travel, but post-pandemic, working from home skews massively towards the most privileged people, those on the highest incomes in our society. And it's the lowest income users of our railways who are the least likely to have flexibility over when they travel. They are the ones being penalised the most by, or who were being penalised the most by, the previous peak rail fare system. This policy, the removal of peak fares, has meant huge savings to my constituents. I'm quite fortunate in the west of Scotland to have quite an extensive rail network compared to other parts of the country. Many of my constituents, of course, commute into Glasgow city centre for work, and I want to run through some of the savings for them. If you live in Paisley and commute to Glasgow at the moment, you're saving £8.50 a week, or £34 a month, as a result of this policy. In Lindsay, it's £9 a week, £36 a month. In Clydebank, it's £9.50 or £38 a month. In Dumbarton, it's £12.50, £50 a month. In Greenock, it's £18, £72 a month. In Helensburgh, it's £19 and £76. And in Largs, it's £27 a month, and £27 a week rather, and £108 a month. I mentioned Bearsden and Mulgay at First Minister's questions a few moments ago due to safety concerns on the roads in the local area. It's also an area that faces serious issues with air pollution due to significant traffic volumes on the roads. And both of those issues are of major concern, particularly because the roads that I mentioned, Drimmen and Duntoker Road, have three primary schools, a high school and an early years centre along them. So it's a public health issue, particularly for our children and young people. If you're a commuter in Mulgay travelling into Glasgow city centre at the moment, you're saving £8.50 a week and £34 a month as a result of the Scottish Greens securing this policy in this year's budget. Indeed, a number of people from Bearsden and Mulgay commute to Edinburgh, and for them they're saving £274 every month. Certainly as a local commuter, I've anecdotally noticed busier peak time services on the Mulgay line. But removing peak fares is only one part of the equation. I've long campaigned for improvements on this line. It was the worst performing in Scotland. At one point, shortly after I was elected, only one in four trains on the Mulgay line arrived or departed on time. I was proud to secure, the Scottish Greens were proud to secure £5 million of improvements to that line a few years ago, and we have seen performance improvements. But the timetable still hasn't been fully restored to the pre-pandemic level. We did have four trains on earth throughout the day before 2020. That's seen as the tipping point for frequency for rail services to be truly attractive. But at the moment, outside of peak time, we still only have half-hourly services. And I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for having met with me about this last year. I would urge ScotRail to make clear what their criteria would be for returning to four trains an hour all day. And the final piece of the puzzle on the Mulgay line, like so many others in Scotland, is infrastructure. That's a line that had two tracks up until 1990, and one was removed. The single track there creates major capacity issues, and there's long been a local consensus on the need for a new Allender station between Hillfoot and Mulgay to service the now larger local population. But you can't add a station to this line, to a single track line, without decreasing services, something that obviously nobody wants to do. Issues on the Mulgay line have a knock-on impact across the central belt, so investment here isn't just a benefit to those who live locally. Improving this line and increasing frequency of services is part of the first stage of the Clyde Metro project, but you can't realise that ambition without bringing the second track back. So I'm concerned by the lack of detail from Transport Scotland on their intentions for the Mulgay line. Adding the second track wouldn't be expensive. The existing track wasn't centred when the other one was removed, so relaying it is a relatively cheap process with just one bridge upgrade required. To close, Presiding Officer, I'm proud the Scottish Greens secured this policy and the funding required for it in the budget. I want to repeat colleagues' thanks to rail unions and climate campaigners. This is a perfect example of how transforming public transport in this country is in the interests of people and planet. I hope that we can make the removal of peak rail fares permanent and see this as an example of the kind of transformative policies that are required across the network.
Thank you, Mr Greer. And I call Richard Leonard, final speaker in the open debate, up to 4 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I remind members of my voluntary register of trade union interests? And can I thank Mark Ruskell for tabling this important debate? Let me start with some basic facts. This year, the Scottish Government has abandoned its 2030 climate change targets. That's a fact. This year, the Scottish Government's budget for trunk roads is up by 25% to over £1 billion. Up by 25%, that's a fact. This year, the Scottish Government's budget for rail services has been cut by 10%. It's now below £1 billion. Slashed by 10%, that's a fact. And this year, the Scottish Government has put rail fares up on ScotRail by nearly twice the rate of inflation, 8.7%. That's a fact. So, peak fares pilots or not, price-sensitive travellers, including some of the poorest passengers, will have stopped using public transport. Now, just 2 weeks ago, the new First Minister, in his first major speech, told us all of his commitment to transparency and openness, highlighting, he said, the importance of Parliament scrutinising our record and our plans. But when it comes to Transport Scotland's evaluation of this policy, presented to Parliament 2 days ago, I have to say that it is completely lacking in crucial detail and lacking in critical evidence, meaning Parliament can neither scrutinise the record nor the plan. So, 6 months into the trial, we don't know if there has been an increase in rail travel at peak times in particular, and if so, whether it has varied by region. We don't know the impact that the pilot has had on rail travel for passengers who already travel off-peak. We don't know to what extent it has got people out of their cars and onto public transport. We don't know, because there were 50 million train journeys over the period covered by the Transport Scotland report, and yet fewer than 1,500 responses to the Transport Scotland survey. So we don't know. What we do know is that because of the 8.7% rise in ScotRail fares on the 1st of April this year, is that if peak fares were reintroduced onto our railways, it would mean ticket prices would skyrocket. It would mean that a day return between Dundee and Edinburgh would go up by 22% during peak travel. From our Drossen Harbour to Glasgow, the fare would go up by 38%. And on Scotland's flagship service between Glasgow and Edinburgh, the price of a day return ticket would shoot up by as much as 48.4%, a near 50% rise overnight. That would, in my view, be reckless, but it would also be heartless and it would be completely unnecessary. Back in March, in Parliament, the Cabinet Secretary spoke of medium to longer term rail fares reform, of our ambitions on net zero, of the need for more radical and bold initiatives, and of public transport as a key enabler for growth and opportunity. These are all reasons, why the off-peak fare trial needs to be made permanent, why there can be no going back. And finally, there's something else as well. The Fares Fair report concluded this year that, I quote, rail fares were extremely complex with a range of products, sometimes as many as 10 fare types on one journey, depending on where and when the journey is being made. It reasoned, passenger research has shown that confusion over buying the right ticket type is acting as a barrier to encouraging modal shift from car to rail, which is why the integration of ticketing, promised for the last 12 years but still awaited, must be introduced. It's why the staff on our trains and in our railway stations must stay. It's why the scrapping of peak fares on our railways must stay. And it's why our ticket offices must stay open as well.
Thank you, Mr. Leonard. I now call point of order, Ross Greer.
Thank you, President Officer. Richard Renner, quite rightly referring to his own register of interest, made me realise that I had not done so, and I should put on the record what's in my voluntary register of interest, a financial donation from the RMT union previous to the most recent Scottish Parliament election.
Thank you, Mr. Greer. That is now on the record. I now invite Fiona Hislop to respond to the debate. Cabinet Secretary, around 7 minutes.
President Officer, thank you to Mark Ruscoe for raising this motion, and all to all members for their contributions. And I too recognise the role of trade unions in calling for this policy, as did Alec Rowley and others. Our public transport system is a key enabler for growth and opportunity, providing the vital link between where people live, learn, earn and socialise. And access to affordable and reliable public transport services helps people and communities unlock opportunities to connect to jobs, education, retail, public services, leisure, recreation, friends and family networks. And our National Transport Strategy vision is for a sustainable, inclusive, safe and accessible system, helping to deliver a healthier, fairer and more prosperous Scotland. And as a key public service, Our public transport system also plays a vital role in supporting our economy, reducing poverty and meeting our ambitious emission reduction targets. To Emma Harper, I would say that there are frustrating UK-wide timetabling issues which currently prevent Scottish services as she set out in some areas, and we do raise that with the UK government. The return of rail services to Leven and Cameron Bridge this week is a demonstration of this government's commitment to invest in improving public services as a means of growing the economy and tackling the climate emergency by encouraging people to shift towards more sustainable modes of travel, such as rail. And, Presiding Officer, to see the faces of the community at Leven and Cameron Bridge celebrating the reopening of this line over the last week has been fantastic. It is part, of course, of a wider investment of over £116 million made by the Scottish Government in sustainable transport in the Levermouth area, connecting the surrounding communities to the new stations, and it will help transform the lives of families and young people in the area for the better. Presiding Officer, on the 16th of May, this SNP Scottish Government also extended the ScotRail peak fares removal pilot. It's a bold initiative which was only possible due to this government bringing ScotRail into public sector control. And as part of the fare review, this Pathfinder pilot was established and has received £40 million in government funding. Now, the pilot aims to simplify complex fares and ticketing options and assess the price sensitivity of car commuters to encourage them to shift to rail. And simplifying ticket prices, I think, is a key factor in helping people shift to public transport and to rail in particular, and I agree with Graeme Simpson and Mark Ruskell on that. The cross-party interest on the pilot shows our collective desire for progress. I've heard directly from people about the positive benefits of removing peak fares. On average, people are saving 34% on return tickets, which can significantly relieve household budgets during the current cost of living crisis. And to counter Richard Leonard's perhaps glass half-empty analysis, I will give some examples. People travelling between Cowdenbeath and Edinburgh save £6.70 per day, equating to saving £1,536 annually if commuting 5 days a week. Those travelling from Montrose to Aberdeen save £5.90 per day, some £1,356 per year if commuting 5 days a week. Now, on Tuesday the 4th of June, Transport Scotland published their interim report on the peak fares pilot, and I would encourage members to read it. This is preliminary research which needs to be set against a background of increasing passenger numbers prior to the pilot. However, the data so far shows that while the initial impact of the pilot was promising, with a 4% increase in rail demand, any impact appears to have faded since the new year, and demand is now close to what it was before the pilot started. Now, there is some emerging evidence of behaviour change, including shifting of travel from off-peak to peak times, and modal shift from car to rail, with results suggesting around one-third of existing rail users have made at least one rail journey, which was previously made using another mode, with two-thirds of those journeys switching from car, and of those new passengers who'd switched to rail, 53% had previously used the car, and a third had switched from bus. The final report will, of course, have a much higher response rate, which I think is what Richard Leonard was asking for, and I would give way to Patrick Harvey.
Patrick Harvey.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. Would she agree that however much information the assessment can currently give us, or a final report, it is only going to be an assessment of the temporary nature, the effect of the temporary nature of this? And if we want people to make changes to their travel patterns, they need to have confidence that those prices are not going to be increased again, throwing them back into confusion or costing them more money. So if you want to see the real benefit of the impact that this change can make, the permanence is what will give people that confidence.
Cabinet Secretary, give the time back.
I think the member is making a reasonable point, and it's why, and as he knows, it was after the House agreement ended that I took the decision, along with colleagues, to extend the pilot even further. But I think that point about permanence and temporary is something that will need to be analysed as part of any future decision-making. To date, of course, there's only been a small increase in demand, and the vast majority of passengers are existing rail users. And by extending the pilot for a further 3 months to a full year overall, we can better understand its impacts in terms of encouraging people to opt for rail and also to understand its benefits. Now, this autumn and winter were the most severe since 2015-16 with 11 named storms, so perhaps we can look at seasonality issues. We do also operate in a challenging financial climate, and of course we do need to ensure value for money for the people of Scotland. So we have to understand what's the best way to encourage use. And it's not obviously just rail, we have to think about bus as well, and we have to set aside that £40 million in that wider context. And I would reiterate that our commitment to achieving net zero by 2045 is unwavering. So the pilot allows us to look at that effectiveness. Transport Scotland will be undertaking a final, more robust evaluation, I can assure members, before the pilot ends. And I have heard the calls from members across this Parliament, the rail trade unions and environmental groups, to continue this policy. And if we could improve on the initial success, I would like to see us provide a solid foundation to demonstrate the success of removing peak fares as a means of encouraging modal shift. I emphasise that we do need to see a significant increase in passenger numbers for the pilot to succeed, and I've asked the rail unions to help in that call. And as the Cabinet Secretary for Transport, I must consider that wider context of the cost of £40 million against other potential alternatives. But I do urge all members to continue supporting this policy, but more importantly, to join the rail unions and others to encourage more work colleagues, family, friends and neighbours to switch to rail for more journeys. And the cross-party support that we hear and have seen in this Parliament today is an important and potential bridge to make sure that we can all work together in improving public transport usage. So I would encourage everyone to spread the word, use the train if you want to see this removal of peak fares continue. President Officer.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting of Parliament until 2 o'clock.